What do you think underpins that appetite then? I mean, religion is a sort of nebulous thing in society, but particularly in a room full of market researchers, it's interesting to find out whether you think there is scope for actually asking people what they think is fair.
Well, I mean, I think there are. I mean, in behavioural psychology, some of the people in the room will know the tests that have been done, the experimental work that's been done. There's Mark Hauser's book, Moral Minds, which some of you may know. There's the kind of, what's it called, the Cognitive Evolutionary Lab at Harvard. You can ask people lots of questions about different cultures, different ages, very diverse range of backgrounds about how they would react in certain circumstances, and you find that people don't. We really disapprove of an intent to do harm, for example, and that's everywhere. And we also understand, everyone understands that actually one does formulate intentions which produce actions, which produce outcomes. I mean, there is individual responsibility. I think one of the difficulties for the liberal left across Europe, actually, is that it's been quite rightly anxious to say, the brute bad luck of economic and social structures has a huge impact on people's life chances, which it obviously does, and they talk the language of brute bad luck and how you're going to mitigate it, but don't talk the language of individual responsibility, because actually a baby knows that it wins a smile or a frown from its father or mother as a consequence of something it's done, he or she has done, by formulating an intent in their head. It's one of the first human experiences. And also, there's a proportional relationship. The better thing you've done, the bigger the smile. The worse thing you've done, the bigger the punishment, which is why justice in all cultures is about a pair of scales, calibrating the punishment, the extent of the gravity of the offence. It's you attempt to get some proportionality in it. And this is where I think, this is for me the origins of morality, if you like. And it's from that that you get to the need for mutual respect. It's from that you get to, we expect reciprocity of exchange. We expect respect of one another. We expect to be treated in a dignified way. But none of that will come unless it's underpinned by a sense of proportionality. And one of the bad things about Britain in 2011 is the extraordinary gap now that exists between the top 0.1% and the rest. Not so much the top 1% and the rest, which has also been getting wider and wider, but the top 0.1%. In fact, on the figures I published in the Fair Pay Review last week, I mean, the top 0.1% in Britain have probably got a bigger share of income than at any time in modern times, bigger than during the 19th century. And we have created a class of pseudo-capitalists at the top of our top companies with their share options, bankers, hedge fund managers, and private equity partners, who have created dynastic fortunes on a scale that hasn't been seen since Warren Hastings plundered India, or the Roman legions came back with the booty out of Africa and Germania in nor AD. I mean, that's the kind of scale of riches that has been, and it's looting actually, and it should be understood as looting, and I think there will be a revolt from it, and indeed I think we're watching a revolt from it across Europe, in that countries are very concerned about takeover, asset stripping, ownership of their assets. The Italians this morning are talking about defending parts of their industry from French takeover. If you allow this to rip for too long, if you allow this disproportionately to rip for too long, it starts actually to menace the kind of wealth-creating goose that lays the golden egg, which is productive capitalism.
Well, you point out there that there is a great deal of negative opinion about the very richest in society, and we've only had to look at the way bankers have become persona non grata at dinner parties to see how that's come about in the UK.
I never get invited to dinner parties with bankers.
but again, it's one of the things that you mention in the book, that at the lower end, public opinion tends to be swayed in rather less predictable ways, and our opinions generally about people at the lowest end of the spectrum are shaped in different ways. That's something that the media elite part of the them category is quite influential.
I mean, you're talking about the deserving undeserving rich and the deserving undeserving poor. I mean, I am quite struck by this. I think we're very quick off the mark point our fingers at, you know, the undeserving poor, the chavs who live their chavtastic lives. and we sneer and mock them. At Oxford and Cambridge, you still have the chav ball, don't you? Obviously, there are members of Britain's millions of disadvantaged people who are undeserving in the sense that, I mean, they have not made a big enough attempt to bootstrap themselves up, and they self-consciously opt for a life of welfare dependency. I think the numbers are very small.